We're glad to be here. All right. Now, the message that I'm going to share to you today is a question, basically, of knowing the fact if you know where are you going. Do you know where you're going?
Heaven.
Are you sure you're going? Before we go to heaven, let us know first and understand, do you know where you are going? And do you know how to get there? Do you know how to get there? Everyone likes to think that they have a sense of direction. Do you have a sense of direction?
Amen.
You know why I love my wife? She doesn't know a place in Dublin. No, I'm selling her. Nobody will let you know. If you ask her a certain place, she'd be like this, where was this, you know? Even though we've been there for like 100 times. And I, for myself, have a good sense of direction. Okay? Do you have a good sense of direction?
No.
No. Okay, everyone likes to think that they have good, you know, some sense of direction. They know the place. They are good in geography. Do you know? Are you good in geography?
Yeah.
No. And they know the direction. Okay. In other words, hindi sila naliligaw. Okay. They're not get, you know, they don't get lost. They would like to think that they're going in the right direction, even when they're heading down the path in the wrong direction. Have you tried a sat-nav in your car? How many times have you heard news that a certain woman, you know, nearly jumped off the cliff of a hill because she was following the sat-nav? One day we were going to Clara Lara, all right? So I turned on the sat-nav, and, you know, there you go. Lo and behold, we were in the middle of the field, all right? Up there in the Wicklow Mountain, and the sat-nav said to me, you have reached your destination. We were in the middle of nowhere. We were in the middle of grass and trees. And so sometimes we think that because we have this technology, you know we are heading down in that direction. Well, in fact, we were heading to a wrong direction. Okay? And we do get lost. And we sometimes ask ourselves, how in the world did I get there? Okay? When you instructed someone to follow the instructions, okay, and did not follow the instruction, therefore they got lost together with their friends or families, right? Sinabi na nga na, you know, you go here, you go there, you turn right, you wait, okay? Some people don't know how to follow instructions. Although sometimes, you know, like what I said about the navigation system, sometimes even though how hard you follow the navigation system, it actually leads you nowhere. But on the other hand, sometimes we actually know where we are going, all right? It's just that sometimes we don't follow the instructions. And when we don't follow the instructions, we get lost. And sometimes we ask ourselves, how did we get into this mess? Okay? You got into this mess because you thought you know where you were going, where you were heading, and it was your willful desire and decision until you realized you shouldn't be here where you thought you were going to. Are you getting the point?
Yeah.
Sometimes, I know I was talking about direction and the physical road and where you are heading to, but sometimes in life, okay, because everything that we do is pertaining to life, is a question of knowing and understanding where you are actually going. Okay, where are you heading? Where is your direction? Our will, listen to this, our internal compass, our desire, our whatever it is that you want to call it, can be very strong. Okay? Diba, we have our own strong will desires in our heart? and it gets you into this decision, you choose that decision, you choose that, and there you are. Alright? And it is so powerful. Okay? Sometimes to the point that it blurs our vision. It can even blur our reality because sometimes we are full of excuses. Okay? Have you ever been into a mess in your life? It's just me. You get into a mess, yeah? Because sometimes, because of this internal will, or your internal compass, or your internal desire that you wanted to do this, and then you get up, you got into this mess in your life. Alright? Because of a wrong decision you have made. Are you with me? Anyone who has an addiction will tell you it is true. Alright? I'm not gonna ask who is an addict here, alright? If you have an addiction, don't tell me you have an addiction. Because I don't want to know. And it could be a good addiction, you know. You're an addict to the Word of God, you know. You're addict to, you know, to the healthy food. You do not attend boodle fights. You know, if you have an addiction, okay, this is just one. Alright? Because we are full of excuses. Just a little bit. It's just a taste. It's just today. Just for today. Alright? And somehow it affects everyone in life and there is no one left out. Okay? Now that we have established that everybody here today is affected in one way or another, let me ask you a question again. Do you know where you're going? There are three categories that I would like to share to you, or three different types of personality, okay, that we're going to identify right now. You can identify yourself as to which one of you is this. Three types of personality is those that think they know where they're going. Do you know where you're going? Maybe you'll say to me, yes, I know. Okay, Samuel upset to me. I'm going there. But those that say they know where they're going, and those that know where they're going. Before we go further, let us know and let us ask the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, give us a revelation this morning so that we may know where we are going. We are heading somewhere, Father God, and sometimes this mess in life affects us one way or the other. But this morning, Lord, allow us to know your will in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, there are three types of personality that I would like to share to you. But before we go further, let us read in the book of Jonah. Do you remember Jonah? In the book of, in chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. One day long ago, God's word came to Jonah, Amittai's son. Up on your feet, and on your way to the big city of Nineveh, preach to them. They're in a bad shape and I can't ignore it any longer. But Jonah got up and went the other direction to Tarshish, running away from God. Amen? He went down to the port of Joppa and found a ship headed for Tarshish. He paid the fare and went on board, joining those going to Tarshish as far away from God as he could get. Okay? Now, let me tell you one thing. Say to the person seated beside you, God has a plan for you. Okay? God has a plan for each and every one of us. Amen? May plano ang Diyos sa atin. Because even before we were in existence, God has already a plan for us. Okay? Nothing is accidental. Okay? Nothing is accident. It is not an accident that you are here. Okay? Because you made a decision to be here. And I believe with all of my heart that God has already planned it for your life. Because that's how important you are to God. You are important enough that God took the time out of his schedule and made a plan completely tailored a one kind of a plan just for you. Listen to the book of Psalms 139, verses 13 to 16. Oh yes, you shaped me first inside, then out. You formed me in my mother's womb. I thank you, high God, you are breathtaking. Body and soul, I am marvelously made. Okay, you are marvelously made. I worship in adoration. What a creation. You are an excellent creation. All right, you know me inside and out. You know every bone in my body. You know exactly how I was made, bit by bit. How I was sculpted from nothing into something, like an open book. You watched me grow from conception to birth. Alright? And the stages of my life were spread out before you, the days of my life all prepared before I even lived one day. Now, if that doesn't let you know how interested God is in you, well, I don't know what would. Okay? You are important to God. That's how He knew you. He knew you, every bone in your body, every bit and bits and pieces in you. Now, God had a plan for Jonah. But Jonah wasn't interested in that plan. Have you ever experienced this? You know, God has a plan for you, yet you ignore it. And you and I have a better suggestion to the Lord, you know. Lord, I think this is better. This is my suggestion to you. This is what you should do to me. Okay? So because Jonah had a better plan in his life. We've read that, you know. God said to Jonah, go to Nineveh. But Jonah saying, hang on a second, Lord, you know. I have a better suggestion for you. I'm going to go to Tarshish. Right? And there you go. Made that plan. Okay? And even though he went the opposite way that God has instructed them, he thought he knew where he was going. Alright? As a matter of fact, if you would have asked him how it was going, probably if you have asked Jonah that time, you say, how are you, Jonah? You say, I'm fine. I am delightful. There you go. Right until things started going south, he probably would have said pretty good. In fact, at that point, he was sleeping like a baby in the bottom of the ship. Okay? Let's read on. But God sent a huge storm at sea, the waves towering. The ship was about to break into pieces. The sailors were terrified. They called out in desperation to their gods, okay, the small gods, all right, and they threw everything they were carrying overboard to lighten the ship. Meanwhile, Jonah had gone down into the hold of the ship to take a nap. There he was, Jonah, at the bottom of the ship, okay? So he was sound asleep. The captain came to him and said, what's this? Sleeping? Get up! Pray to your God! Maybe your God will see we're in trouble and rescue us. Then the sailors said to one another, let's get to the bottom of this. Let's draw straws to identify the culprit in this ship who's responsible for this disaster. So in other words, somebody who has a balat in the puet, you know? Somebody has a... I don't know how I say it. But it's somebody who has a patch. Somehow it's... You are the jinx. Okay?
Oh, yeah.
So they draw straws and Jonah, lo and behold, got the short straw. Alright? So it is actually planned by God. It was planned by God. So sometimes our plan altering comes at a great expense to others. So there he was, Jonah, with an instruction from the Lord to do this, yet he did the opposite way. Alright? So what happened? It affected the people whom he was, you know, whom he was with. Alright? So it was at great expense to other people. So what happened was, the people, you know, in this ship threw everything they were carrying overboard to lighten the ship. And sometimes we think we know where we're going, yeah? And others pay a great price to get us there. Think about the consequences of our choices in life, okay? Sometimes it affects the life of other people. It is not only the person, but actually the other persons in that man or woman or friends of yours in their life. Are you with me? You don't just affect literally the person, okay? Let's say I had a fight with Cherry, for example. Alright? We had a big, massive argument. It's not between me and Cherry only. It would affect the husband. It could affect the children. It could affect my wife. It could affect my children also. Do you understand? So it affects every choices that we make in life. Affects not only the direct person involved, but it actually affects somehow the other people surrounding them. Okay? So Jonah have said, this is what he said. Sorry, I didn't put that. But anyway, Jonah had said, throw me overboard into the sea. Then the storm will stop. It's all my fault. I'm the cause of the storm. Get rid of me and you'll get rid of the storm. So then they prayed to God, oh God, don't let us drown because of this man's life and don't blame us for his death. You are God. Do what you think is best. So they took Jonah and threw him overboard, okay, the poor man. All right, imagine yourself, you are Jonah, and you are being thrown into the middle of the sea, okay? And immediately, the sea was quieted down, okay? Humupa ang bagyo. The storm stopped. So the sailors were so impressed, and they were no longer terrified by the sea, but in awe of God. Imagine that. Imagine you are Jonah, no? They throw you overboard, and then all of a sudden, there was quiet. There was silence. And will you be terrified, like, oh God, you know, what is this? So, you know, they were so impressed, okay? So what did they do? They worshiped God. They worshiped God and offered a sacrifice and made vows. Then God assigned a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the fish's belly 3 days and three nights. Okay? Now, even those sailors who had no idea who God was, after they saw his mighty hand and the mighty power of God, of what he was capable of, had enough sense to change their plans. Amen? Okay? So there they are, they do not believe in God, and yet, because of what happened, okay, they worship God, they believed with all of their hearts, with the God that Jonah was worshiping. Now let's go back to Jonah. He was swallowed in the meantime by a massive fish. For how long? 3 days and three nights. Okay? Can I repeat it again? The sailors threw Jonah overboard, alright? And the sea stopped. I mean, the storm stopped. And you know what happened to them? Immediately, they worshiped God. Here comes Jonah, alright? The stubborn Jonah. Can you identify yourself with Jonah? Swallowed by a massive fish, alright? Stayed in the fish for 3 days and three nights. Are you getting the point? Yeah. He could have repented immediately and said to God, Lord, forgive me for my stubbornness. I know you are talking to me right now, and I want to follow you, and I want to obey you right now. Took him 3 days and three nights. Now, I don't know if you have ever been into a fish, inside a fish tummy. I don't think so. I don't think there is a mattress inside the fish. And I don't think it is air conditioned or it is with heater. And I don't think it is an angel's breath, perfume, inside the massive fish tummy. It smells, it stinks. It smells fish, obviously. And here comes Jonah for 3 days and 3 nights. And he thought he knows where he is going. Okay? He could have repented, you know, had an immediate reaction at that point. He could have said, you know, Lord, now, you know, you win. I give up. You are God. Do what you think is best. And what I think is not important. He could have said that. 3 days later, you know, seriously. Now, at least, okay, but at least Jonah had realized his mistake after 3 days. Amen? Can we ask ourselves, how long? How long is our stubbornness? How many days? How many weeks? How many months? How many years? And I tell you, some people have been running the wrong direction all their lives from God. Amen. Still thinking they know where they're going. Still thinking they know their destiny. How long has God been chasing you in your life? What is everyone's standard answer when you ask them how things are going? They would say, oh, I'm fine. But let me tell you something. Things are not always fine. Sometimes things need to change and we need to be honest with ourselves and others. Yeah. You know, in Ireland, when they ask you a question, they don't really ask you a question. If you see them, you meet them at work or wherever, how are you? They're not actually interested in you. It is basically just to say hi, hello. That's one thing I learned. I don't know if you have learned that. Because when I was in the previous hospital where I was working, when they ask you about how are you, you kind of think to, you know, and then you start to saying things about your relationship, and you said about, you know, because that's what was in my heart. Yeah. All right? And then they would be like, I think that's TMI. You know what's TMI? Too much information. They don't really want to know what is happening in your relationship. Basically, they just want to say, hi, hello. So I learned a massive lesson, you know? Because what happened was I became in the tabloid after what I have said. So I have learned that lesson, all right? So what I'm trying to say is that people would say to you sometimes, oh, I am fine. Well, in fact, deep inside, okay, we are sometimes hurting. We sometimes have had a family whom we have lost in our life, and yet we are still smiling. We are not in good condition with our father or with our mother, and yet we are trying to be fine. All right? Are you with me? So, sometimes things need to change and we need to be honest with ourselves and others. Now, let's go back to Jonah. Jonah turned his direction around and was able to accomplish amazing things for the Lord. Okay? Therefore, after Jonah had realized it for 3 days and 3 nights, he followed the Lord and the whole city of Nineveh was spared from God's wrath. No matter where you're headed, God can turn your situation around too. God is a respecter of person. Now imagine this. Now Jonah disobeyed God literally. He's supposed to go north. He went south. All right? God did not throw He did not strike him with the lightning right there and there because of his stubbornness. Okay? He still respected and he has given Jonah a second chance. Because last week we learned that God is a God of second and third and fourth and fifth and sixth and seven and eight and 1,000 chances in our lives. Amen? So He has given him a second chance. Okay? God is a respecter of persons. Anyone can do amazing things when they realize God's plan in their life. So, now let's go to the second example. Those that say they know where they're going, okay? Ay, ito pala yan. Those that say they know where they're going, okay? Do you know where you're going? Now, when I think about this, you know, in this category, I can't help to think about Apostle Paul, who is formerly known as Saul, okay? Do you know him? Have you read the book of Acts? Paul, okay, he used to be Saul, right? In religious circles, everyone knew him. He was a Pharisee. What is a Pharisee at that time? It's equivalent somehow to a priest, okay? They're in the priesthood. They studied religion all of his life. He has studied religion all of his life. And if anyone would have thought to be qualified to say that they know where they're going, it would have been him. He has a massive resume. He is the best. He is the most qualified. Alright? After all, he was busy doing the Lord's work, wasn't he? Do you know what he was doing during his time? Or was he doing the will of God? Just because we are confident and say we know where we're going in our walk through life doesn't mean it's the right way. Okay? Now let's read on. All this time, Saul was breathing down the necks of the master's disciples out for a kill. Meaning, he was the persecutor of the church, the very first church in the book of Acts. What he was doing, okay, is he was out for the kill. He went to the chief priest and got arrest warrants to take to the meeting places in Damascus so that if he found anyone there belonging to the way, you know this word, the way? This is the first name of the very first church that was ever founded by the Christians after Jesus Christ departed. Okay? In the first century. Okay? Yeah. All right? So they are the way. Okay, so whether men or women, he could arrest them and bring them to Jerusalem. There he was. Remember, he's a religious man. He's a Pharisee, and yet he was out for a kill. He set off. When he got to the outskirts of Damascus, he was suddenly dazed by a blinding flash of light. As he fell to the ground, he heard a voice. So, why are you out to get me? And then he said, who are you, master? I am Jesus, the one you're hunting down. I want you to get up and enter the city. In the city, you'll be told what to do next. Alright? Did you get the picture? Alright? So he thought he was carrying out God's plan for his life. What he found out was that he had been taught and what he had been saying was not God's plan for his life at all. He was about to find out firsthand. It wasn't about religion any longer. It was about a relationship, and this was his introduction. He was instructed to go to Damascus, and there he would find a man named Ananias who would help him make sense of it all. And this man, Paul, who said he knew where he was going, was suddenly blinded and being led every step of the way by someone else. So this is the continuation. So he said, get up and go over to Straight Avenue. Ask at the house of Judas for a man from Tarsus. His name is Saul. He is there praying. He has just had a dream. By the way, this is God talking to Ananias. Okay, he has just had a dream in which he saw a man named Ananias enter the house and lay hands on him so he could see again. And Ananias protested. Okay, sabi ni Ananias, Master, you can't be serious. Everybody's talking about this man and the terrible things he's been doing. Because remember, he was persecuting the church. He was out for a kill. His reign of terror against your people in Jerusalem, and now he is shown up here with papers from the chief priest that give him license to do the same to us. So he was allowed. And then, but the master said, "Don't argue. Go. I have picked him as my personal representative to non-Jews and kings and Jews. And now I'm about to show him what he's in for, the hard suffering that goes with this job." So Ananias went and found the house, placed his hand on blind Saul, and said, "Brother Saul, the master sent me. The same Jesus you saw on your way here, he sent me so you could see again, and he is filled with the Holy Spirit." No sooner were the words out of his mouth than something like scales fell from Saul's eyes. He could see again. He got to his feet, was baptized, and sat down with them to a hearty meal. I'm sorry if you cannot read it properly. But anyway, let me tell you one thing. Paul Hovey has said once that a blind man's world is bound by the limits of his touch. If you're blind, okay, picture this. You are limited by your touch. You know, where you're going is depending on what you can touch. An ignorant man's world is bound by the limits of his knowledge. If you have no knowledge, you have no power. Okay? Sabi nga ni Ernie Barong. And a great man's world is bound by the limits of his vision. If you have vision, that is boundless, that is limitless, isn't it? You are not bounded by that. So that is, Paul's vision and his sense of direction have never been better. Only he had a new compass. His new compass was the Holy Spirit. He no longer would say he knew where he was going, but he could say with his confidence, he knew that the journey would be amazing. Because he knew the one who was going to guide him every step of the way until he reached his destination. And what amazing things he did for the kingdom when he embraced God's plan for his life. He has done a lot. He is the missionary, the greatest missionary ever told. And that's what Jesus, that's what God has said, you know, "I will make him the missionary to the Jews and to the Gentiles." And that's what happened. He was the greatest man ever alive. You know, when I get to heaven, I'm going to shake his hand. I'm going to embrace Paul. Because if not for Paul, we would not know the gospel of Christ into this present time. Because we are not Jews. Are you a Jew? We are not Jews. We belong to the Gentile nation. And he was the greatest missionary ever. Alright? Alright? Third, those who know where they are going. Okay? Do they really know where they're going? Well, nobody knows the future except for God. So therefore, no one can really know what tomorrow holds for them. But what do they know? He is the one who holds our tomorrow. Amen? They know and cultivate their relationship with God each and every day. David was such a man. From his youth till his last breath, he knew God. It says in the book of Psalms 139 verses 1 to 6, "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know me when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search me. You search out my path." Thank you, Ate. "And my lying down, and are acquainted with all of my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord," he knew it altogether. "You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it." He knew. Whether he was a shepherd attending his father's flock, or facing the giant on the battlefield, or leading the whole nation of Israel, it didn't matter what happened. God would see him safely through any situation. He knew where he was going because he put his faith in God's plan for his life. And he knew if God knew where he was going, that's all that mattered. Because he knew. Sorry. Ginahit a bit. This is just my... What's this? My conclusion in this message. Okay? That is the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to give you hope in the future. That is His plan for you. And as I conclude this, let me tell you a story about the 19th century agnostic Thomas Huxley. Okay? Thomas Huxley was the one who promoted Darwinism and humanism on his attacks to Christianity. Huxley was actually in Dublin, and he was rushing to catch a train, and he climbed aboard one of Dublin's famous horse-drawn taxis and said to the driver, "Hurry, I'm almost late, drive fast." Off they went at a furious pace, and Huxley sat back in his seat and closed his eyes. Okay. After a while, Huxley opened his eyes and glanced out the window to notice that they were going in the wrong direction. Realizing that he hadn't told the driver where to take him, he called out, "Do you know where we are going?" The driver replied, "No, Your Honor, but I'm driving very fast." So that was the instruction anyway. All right. But sometimes we don't know where we are going, and we're just driving too fast. Okay? Now let me ask you a question again. Do you know where you're going today? Sometimes we think we know where we are going because we already laid out that plan. We already made that decision. We already made that. Do you know the peace of God in that will save you, that will see you safely through? No matter where you go in your life, you can step out of faith and start amazing things in your life. Like Paul, like David, like Jonah, like all great women, men and women of faith. Because they know who God is through an amazing relationship with His amazing Son, Jesus. And we have the gift of the Holy Spirit living in us and guiding us all the way. And we can do the same as the great men and women of faith that we know that was written in the Word of God. And He can do the same for you because it's all part of His plan for your life. Because the Bible says, "I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to give you hope and a future." Can I ask you one more question? Do you know where you're going? You can know today. Sam has said a while ago that, "Do you know where you're going?" "Yes, I'm going to heaven." How certain are you that you are going to heaven? The Bible says there is only one way to heaven. And that's why I believe that in the early Christians in 180, they named their church as the way. Because they know for a fact that there is only one way to heaven. You know that way? Who is that way? And Jesus himself had said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except by me. Well, Jesus saying that, not me. Right? I'm not me. There is only one way. And we thought that there are so many other ways. So maybe I can go to Jesus by doing this and this and that and that. No. The Bible is even very clear when he said there is only one mediator between man and God. And that is Jesus. No one else. Hindi mo na kailangan magpadirapa, magpaluhudhul, magpahulog-hulog. You know, you just... And kill yourself and lash yourself with lashes and everything just to be accepted by God. The Bible is very clear in saying that there is only one way, there is only one mediator between man and God, and that is Jesus Christ. And he has a plan for you and for me. Unless you have that relationship with Christ. Paul, as an example, was a Pharisee, a religious person. He knew the law inside and out. He knew every 400 laws that was written in the history of mankind. Or maybe there's even probably more than 400 or maybe 600. He knew that with all of his heart. And yet he thought he knew where he was heading to. And yet he was actually doing the opposite of God's plan in his life, persecuting the churches at that time. Are you with me?
Amen.
So do you know where you're going? To get to heaven, there is only one way. Let us all stand, let us pray.